Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you to the organizer for inviting me here. So I was asked to discuss what is new about diagnosis and treatment in 20 minutes, and the first answer I will give to this question is that, in fact, in this field, everything is new or has been new during the recent weeks. First, let's start with diagnostic issue. You all know that the problem with diagnostic issues is first the biosafety that we have to follow when we process any specimens linked to suspect Ebola cases. You have here two pictures that show the different approach, either in the field or in a modern laboratory here in Geneva. But you see that basically it's the same kind of approach. But of course, behind the biosafety regulations that we have to follow, at least in our countries, we need to adapt to real-life conditions. And I will stress that the risk to use clinical specimen in an appropriate setting does not need a BSL for laboratory, and that the fact that everything has moved to BSL-3 is in full agreement with the real risk to handle these specimens in a real-life situation. There is a recent guidelines that has been published by WHO that endorse the fact that you can use BSL-3 facilities to handle these specimens that has just been published. I just put this as a reference, and you see that these guidelines also try to adapt to different situations, either in the field or the type of PCR that I used, including the automated PCR. These guidelines, and I'm not sure that I fully understand what this means, automated PCR, and it seems that if you use automated PCR, you can decrease the level of protection. This said, again, I do really not really understand what does it means for me. An automated or manual PCR needs the same kind of approach. So let's move to first the basic diagnostic knowledge we have to keep in mind when we discuss diagnosis. At the time our patient is presenting with Ebola symptoms, generally they already are at the peak of the viral load here in terms of viral load in the blood. Culture is of course never used in the field, and the window of opportunity to isolate the virus from blood cultures is very short. So the main parameters that we use as a diagnostic tool that is reliable, specific, and sensitive is the molecular assays on the, and the PCR-based assays. But when we use PCR-based diagnostic assays, I like to remember to everyone basic knowledge about this. First, you need a reference sequence, which was not formally the case at the early stage of the outbreak. You need to identify a conserved target for the two primers and the one probe you are using for real-time PCR. And there is one point that you also have to keep in mind is the importance of the pre-analytic phases. And in the field, I have seen very frequently specimens that were not kept on the cooler and that were at high temperature for several hours, which is basically not possible to do in another way. But the cold chain that we try to conserve here in Europe is not possible sometimes in the field and could impair the sensitivity of your assays. Do not expect equal sensitivity for all targets and for all tests. You have to expect different sensitivity according to the different tests that are used in the field. And most importantly, which is a very important point, and there has been some delay to get sequence of strains that was circulating in the field, you need to adapt the assays to the genetic drift of the virus. At this time, there is three assays approved by the FDA and WHO during the, no, during the outbreaks, only two assays have been approved, but several comments needs to be done here. First, I have not seen any publications on these assays. I have not seen the detailed validations, and most important, I have not seen clinical validations of these assays. And I failed to get any information during the outbreaks on primers and probes, including from the CDC and other federal agencies, which was not the case for H1N1 and the SARS outbreaks or the MERS coronavirus. So very special situations here. When you talk about real-time RT-PCR, you have all seen that we are talking about CT values. Let's talk a little bit about CT values. CT values is the threshold that we consider as positive when we have an amplification curve like here. You see different amplification curve here with dilution of 10 to the 10. I just want to remember basic knowledge about this. First, a CT value is not a viral load. You can compare CT value in the same patients over the time, but it's not per se a viral load. You have to remember that three CT values are approximately one log of viral load. So if you have a difference of three CT values, you have 10 times more virus or 10 times less. You need a standardization of the specimens, which is easy in the plasma, but not in other fluids. So you cannot use viral load in other fluids. It's very complicated. You need to know the linear range of the specification of the assays, which is not the case for all the assays that have been used. Of course, you don't have international units, so you cannot compare the results in one setting in another. And this is very important for clinical studies and investigations. And then you need to know exactly the kinetic of the viral load during the course of disease, and this is not perfectly known during the first phase of the disease for Ebola, of course, because you don't know how the kinetic of the virus has been in one given patient before the peak of the symptoms. You have here an example of the patients that was hospitalized here in Geneva, and you see that we observed after hospitalization a very sharp decrease of the viral load associated also to some treatment. So the conclusions might be that we have an effect of the treatment, but what I want to show here is that we can have a very rapid decline of the viral load. And this decline of viral load here is summarized here on these two curves. You see that the decline before the introduction of the treatment of hospitalization was already here, and you can estimate a decay of the viral load. And then when the patient was hospitalized, you can also assess the decay of the patients. The problem here is that we don't know if this is the natural course of the disease or if it is the impact of the treatment. Then there is other issues here. For example, in red, you have one given assay. In blue, another assay that have been used in these patients. And you see that for at the end of the disease, you have some assays that are still positive, others are still negative. And you really expect this with real-time PCR. You have at the end, when you have a very, very low viral load, some kind of random effect that you expect with these assays, so it's not unusual. So when you base your decisions, it's not unusual to get a positive assay and negative assay when the viral load is very low. One decision that has been taken in the field is to discharge patients when we had negative blood RT-PCR in the blood. I have to say that I don't know where are the evidence for this. And the question here is related to other fluids. And you see that when the viral load has been negative in blood, you still have positive viral load either in stools or in urines or sometimes in other fluids. And this is give you a perspective to use a viral blood PCR to discharge a patient. I will not go in details about all the PCR assays that have been developed, but very rapidly many companies developed commercial assays that some have been used in the field. What we need in the field is easier to use assays, and one solution might be to use loop-mediated isothermal amplifications. And in blue here, you have the potential advantage of this approach that use constant temperature, no thermal cyclers, and could be quite rapid. And the detection could be by naked eye. You don't need a special device to read the results. There are other interesting approach here with a glucose meters that could identify the positivity of a PCR, but this is not really science fiction, but it might be a future solution soon. Then you have the rapid point of care test, the either antigen-based or PCR-based. And when we are talking about PCR test, basically, I don't think that we are talking about point-of-care test. You need really still quite experienced technicians, even if it's a gene expert test. Rapid diagnostic test based on immunochromatographic or other antigen detections. are also available, and what I want to do here is just to specify the characteristic of this test in terms of sensitivity and specificity. And the rapid diagnostic test based on the detection of antigens, I have to keep in mind that if the sensitivity and the specificity is not perfect, the positive and negative predictive values will clearly depend on the situation where you are using death, particularly the prevalence of the disease, and death needs to be integrated in a full clinical settings where you take decisions of isolation based on the different result of the assays and taking in account also the prevalence of the disease. Now, let's move now to antiviral drugs, and I will focus here only on direct-acting antiviral therapies, not on other therapies. I will just discuss the therapies that act directly on the virus. Of course, the first type of therapies that come in mind is the so-called ZMAB and then ZMAP, which is a cocktail of three different GP-specific neutralizing antibodies that have been shown to be very efficient in non-human primates when they are inoculated with the virus. The numbers of primates that have been inoculated is relatively small, but the difference compared to those that are not receiving the drug is striking because the mortality is generally 100% in the primates that are not receiving the drug or the antibodies. Then the ZMAB that has been given to four, five, or six patients, including the one that we had here in Geneva, was not designed to be used in the clinical settings. It's really an experimental drug that has not followed the regulation in terms of production for the drugs that could be used in humans. The next step was to produce the ZMAP. The ZMAP at the early stage of the outbreak, approximately 35 patients were available. It's again a combination of different chimeric antibodies that target three different epitopes, and that have shown already also full protection of non-human primates that are inoculated with the Kikwit variant. Studies have been repeated during the outbreak with the Makona variant, which is the one that is circulating in West Africa, and have shown also similar efficacy. You also have to keep in mind that the virus is evolving and that we see mutations at the nucleotide level on epitopes that are known to be targeted by the three antibodies, but we hope that using three different antibodies, one or two mutations will not impact the efficacy of the drug. And randomized studies are ongoing in Sierra Leone and in Liberia, if I am correct. Then there is another one that is for which I did not find any solid informations, called MIL-77, manufactured by the Chinese company, and that has been given in one nurses in the UK. I cannot detail much more on this drug, but it's also a cocktail of different antibodies with a different type of production, and hopefully we will get more information on this soon. Another drug is favipiravir that has the advantages to be accepted as an antiviral drug for influenza in Japan under special circumstances. It's a polymerase inhibitor, and it seems that during the outbreaks we have seen more and more drugs that are efficacious that could inhibit the Ebola virus. Sometimes you don't really know whether it's really true. It's in vitro models or sometimes animal models. Still, favipiravir was quite convincing and went to clinical studies. And basically, the result of these clinical studies that were not randomized showed that compared to historical control, you had a reduction of mortality, particularly in patients that had a relatively low viral load, and in those that had not renal failure at admissions. This is a primary and a pilot studies that probably needs to be confirmed if needed. At this time, as you understand, it's not possible anymore to study these drugs. Another drug is the TKM Ebola, which is a cocktail of small interfering RNA targeting different protein of the virus that has shown some protection in non-human primates at high dose and for 7 days. This cocktail has also been tested and adapted to the current variants and has shown also protection in non-human primates with the new variants. It has been used in one or two or three patients evacuated medically during the current outbreaks, but we still need, of course, more investigation in humans to be sure that it's a possibility. You also have convalescent plasma that is under study in different parts of West Africa using this type of mobile laboratory to prepare the convalescent plasma. Convalescent plasma has been studied in non-human primates after administration of several doses over several days and seems to protect some patients. We have to know that, to keep in mind that we don't know in some patients that have been transported in Europe or in the US whether this could be associated also with other side effects like pulmonary edema or Trelly syndrome in some patients that received this convalescent plasma. You also have other antiviral therapies in the pipeline. One that started the clinical study was brincidofovir that has been studied in Liberia, but unfortunately the study was stopped given the decline of the outbreak, which is not unfortunate, but the drug could not be studied as it was planned. So we don't know at this time whether this drug could have any impact. We also have some doubt in terms of investigations in animal models. It's a broad spectrum activity against DNA viruses, and Ebola is an RNA virus. It's a drug that might be used largely in transplant patients to treat CMV and other DNA viruses. And then you have other drugs that are planned in development. Again here, antisense oligonucleotides, and I give this example just to tell you that in many of these drugs, there are examples of drugs that are not being used yet in clinical practice. In clinical practice, we don't use siRNA or oligonucleotides yet to treat any viral infections, so we fight with two different types of investigations, one a proof of concept with new drugs, and in another way, we also have to prove that the drug is efficient to treat Ebola. So it's a difficult task. Then I could make a list of many, many small and not so small and not so new compounds that have been tested or are in the pipeline or have been tested using high throughput investigations. But one interesting observation was done by MSF in north of Liberia, in Foya, when they had the problem to get artemether and lumefantrine. They had a stock that was not available anymore, so they used artesunate and amodiaquine in place of artemether. And doing this during 2 or 3 weeks, they showed that they had a reduction of mortality that suggests that death was associated for a reason or another, whether it's a direct antiviral or another type of effect, with a significant reduction of mortality. Death will need to be further investigated also. So in conclusions, for the diagnostic part, in my view, RT-PCR and molecular tests are still the gold standard for Ebola diagnostic. A rapid diagnostic test might be of interest, but they have absolutely to be integrated in a clear decision of clinical endpoints and what to do in the presence of a positive and negative test, whether you have to confirm or not to confirm by a molecular test. There are no current validated treatments. For the first time, we have to say also that we use a cocktail of antibodies to cure a viral disease. In my knowledge, this is the first time we have Only one relative example, it's parvovirus in immunocompromised patients, but otherwise we don't have any similar example in clinical practice. So again, we try new avenue in a new disease. We really need appropriate clinical investigations. There is a very difficult debate of those that promote randomized clinical studies in the field as the reference, but I am quite convinced this is not the unique solution. So what we missed probably during these outbreaks is very rapid virological investigation. I am quite sure that pilot studies, even if they are not randomized, but very well done, very well followed, could bring the first basement for further randomized studies, if it's possible. And then, of course, I did not discuss supportive care. You have an example here of the patients that will be discussed further by my colleagues. And of course, we all know that I discussed here for a few minutes about direct acting antiviral drugs, but the most important probably during the outbreak was the supportive care. That was quite different here in Europe than in Africa. Thank you for your attention.